And we're back. Oh. Welcome back. We've been so busy chatting. You get three autism moms together and that's what happens.
Yes.
But we're back with our wonderful guest, Laura Marroquin. Am I saying it right, Marroquin?
You are, yes.
Okay. And you are a mom. You have more than one child. Tell us just briefly about your children.
Sure. I have a 13-year-old, so I have a new teenager in my house,
which is quite a new challenge.
Mm-hmm. And then I have twins, and they are 9 years old now, and they are Justin and Jessica.
And Justin is the one who had the diagnosis of autism. When did you start to see that things were different, that you might need to pay attention and do something about what was different? And what did you subsequently do?
Justin was a preemie, so we kind of always watched our children, a little bit differently. But at about 18 months, he really started to have those autistic type symptoms with the no eye contact and a lot of aggressive tantrums that were just, you couldn't bring him out of it. It was a 45-minute ordeal where you're trying to deal with him multiple times a day. We had that.
You noticed that probably it was in stark relief because Jessica was not doing these things. You had a twin, too.
Right. And we saw that Jessica was progressing in her language and starting to take off, where Justin had 5 words. At the time he was diagnosed at 2.5, he had 5 words.
Wow.
And then he got a lot of obsessions. So for Justin, it was all about the opening and closing doors and the light switches. So it was a matter of the fact we put switches all around our house, way up top, so doors couldn't be continually open and closed because it was such an obsession.
I remember you talking about going on an elevator with him, and then an elevator was a big ordeal.
Yes, it was. You could not get on or you could not get off, whichever way you were facing because of that door function.
Wow. And so what did you do about all this? You had all these behaviors. What path did you take?
Well, we did like a lot of young parents is we talked to the pediatrician and we're kind of referred maybe there's something going on speech-wise. That was what they first said. And so after realizing the behaviors were getting so much worse that I knew that it was more than speech. And so I think the first thing a mom can do is get educated.
Yeah.
And that's, I spent a lot of time doing that really early on. And even before going to that neurologist appointment is understanding what was maybe coming down the pike and kind of preparing
yourself.
So did you
think autism? As you started to do your research, thinking autism?
I did.
Did your pediatrician lead you to believe that it might be autism, and did he pick it up quickly?
No. Our pediatrician talked about the speech deficits.
Okay.
And so once we had our first assessment with the regional center here in California, we have that assessment, that's where they said, you know what, we think there might be some behaviors here as well that need to be addressed.
Okay. Yeah, we should explain that in California we have the regional center where children are often sent to be diagnosed and assessed.
Yeah, and different states have different things. I know California is not the only state that has that. New York has something that's like it. It's called something different. Than regional centers, but not every state has the benefit of that.
That's right.
But fortunately in California we do.
Yeah.
So what an interesting way to come to it, though, that you were thinking speech, went to the regional center, and they said maybe there's something more.
They did, and I remember now them saying, okay, we think that there's some serious things going on here. We're going to ask that you take your child for 8 hours a week of therapy, And I thought, what the heck, 8 hours? I don't have enough time to take a shower as a mother of twins so forth. There's no way. No, I'll take 4 hours. Thank you very much. Going down that path now, I see, wow, the error in my ways on that one.
So you took 4 hours and started.
That was actually 2 hours of speech and 2 hours of ABA.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And then what made the red light go off that you needed more?
Yeah.
We ended up getting the diagnosis. So went to that neurologist, and they said, yeah, this is definitely autism. And so, being that it's autism, you need to have more hours of behavioral therapy.
And did they say, because if you were shocked at eight hours, did they say 40? Did they say 30? Did they give you any indication?
They said 25 at that time. Yeah, and so we I started realizing that that was, in my research, that that was more of the norm.
Right.
And so when Justin was diagnosed, I think he had 12, and then we steadily built that up to 30 hours a week.
Okay. So he's in a full-on program at the age of, what, 3?
Yes, full-on program, full-on with CARD, Center for Autism and Related Disorders. And I have to say that was part of my education, was knowing that there is a difference in ABA providers, and that you really want a provider that is very, that is taking a lot of records and very, I don't know all the proper terms now, but
taking the data, doing the research.
Exactly, and giving you those reports that you can really look at to see the progress or non-progress.
Right.
And how you need
what
to change
areas
gears.
You need to develop and how you can reassess the program.
Right.
Laura, in addition to getting the ABA for Justin, you were very forceful in getting him provided with an ABA therapist in the school.
Yes, we were. We at that transition, we talked about California. A lot of times you transition out of the regional center funding into the school district. So the school district had recommended a regular a special classroom for Justin within the district. And at the time, our family was very partial to a preschool that Justin's twin was going to, which was a typical preschool. And I really wanted him there. And in my knowledge base, I realized that for Justin, the severity of his autism, he would do best with typical peers. And so we did. We fought the school district to achieve that, and we're very fortunate that we were successful in getting that.
And, you know, I want to go back to something that you said because I thought it was really interesting, the idea that he would do better with neurotypical kids because of the severity of his autism. So somebody is listening to that. I know exactly what you mean, but for somebody else who maybe doesn't understand the thought process behind that, explain what you mean by that.
Well, Justin's, he had some language, and he, as we talked about, he had a lot of behaviors. He didn't have a ton of sensory issues that needed to be addressed. So he was, when he was diagnosed, he was in the moderate autism diagnosis. And so I know kids that have more severity might need more, a different type of setting for them. So for Justin, we wanted him modeling typical peers. Because we knew that that research shows that if they're able to do that, then helps the child advance.
So did he go into preschool at age 3 then?
He actually, our therapy team said, you know what, his behaviors are so severe, he cannot be in a preschool setting at this point. And so we delayed it about an extra 4 months, but it just gave them that extra time to get him so that he could come out of a tantrum after a half hour maybe instead of an hour, that kind of thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
So at what point did he start preschool?
So he started at almost 3 and a half, and we the way we were able to successfully get our funding was we were able to gradually get him into preschool. So we started him at 2 days a week, and then we did 3 days a week, and we were able to bring our CARD therapist with us and do that transition.
And you said you had to fight for that.
We did.
Lawyers?
We did. Oh, definitely.
Okay.
Lawyers, mediation on the first time, and then the year later, we almost went to due process. We settled right before due process.
So there was no part of this that was easy. Let's just say that.
No.
It was a battle, and it took time and energy, and I'm sure there was a lot of emotion that went along with that.
But
was it worth it?
Oh my gosh. He was on the mound pitching yesterday. He's 9 years old now, and this little guy, they were up by 5 runs. Coach put him in, and he walked every single batter, and he lost the game for them. You know what? He handled it, and he handled it when he got to the car, and he handled it as I tucked him in, and there's no way that would have happened 4 years ago.
Yeah.
So to those who say recovery, and we've heard this time and time again, that recovery from autism is a myth. It's simply not possible. What do you say to that?
I say come to my house. I say I live with the living proof that it's possible. And some people say, well, he wasn't diagnosed right. Well, you know what,
and
Justin,
what do you think about that?
He had 4 doctors diagnose him with autism. I mean, I don't know what else to show people about it. You know, he was
exactly.
He was autistic.
And so we kind of skipped over a lot of stuff.
We did.
He was going to school. But at what point did he get a recovered diagnosis? At what point was that deemed
he
a reality?
He was 5 and a half. Yeah.
So fairly quickly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Fairly quickly.
And you were doing other important interventions in your mind. What were some of those?
Well, we saw that he had some real gut issues. I mean, part of his downward spiral in the beginning was he had chronic diarrhea. Mm-hmm. And so we really needed to address his body so that we knew that he could feel good and then learn better. Because nobody's going to go to work well when you're feeling awful. Mm-hmm. So why Absolutely. Would we expect him to learn? So we did. So we, for Justin, we took away gluten and casein. We took away soy, potato, and sugar for a while. We saw an immediate transformation. His toe walking went away at that point. And then we introduced methyl B12 to Justin and saw great jumps in his language. For us, we also did chelation, transdermal chelation. We did hyperbarics. So we tried a lot.
And we tried a lot of therapies to see what he might respond to.
Right.
And I think as parents, we learn that not all children respond to the same thing. All our kids are unique. All our kids are individuals. And just as we respond differently to things, our kids respond differently to things.
Yeah, so. I think it's so important to remember that there's no cookie cutter for autism. There's no one thing. You know, we do know that the only scientifically proven effective treatment for all of our kids is ABA. And clearly that made a huge difference for your child.
That's it.
But I think that there are always a lot of things that we talk to parents that help that along, as you said. If your gut issues, you're not going to be a good learner if those gut issues aren't taken care of. So really important for parents to follow their instincts and to see the seek out the specialist that they need for their individual child. Let's take a little bit of a break. But when we come back, let's talk about what it was like your child transitioning and how he changed and what he's like now. And what you think was really important to you in this journey. But stick with us, and if you have a question, now's a great time to ask your question of this fabulous mom about recovery. We'll be back in just a minute. Welcome back to
Welcome
Let's
back.
Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy.
And we're here with Laura Marroquin, who is Director of Programs and Development for ACT Today, Autism Care and Treatment Today. And she is also the mother of a recovered son with autism. And we've been hearing about his journey, Justin's journey, and asking you about what you felt some of the most important milestones were along that journey. How about, from your perspective as a parent, if a mom is out there listening, mom or dad today, and they're saying, "Wow, this just seems a little overwhelming, everything you have to do," how could you give them some maybe, you know, 3 or 4 tips on what you think are the most important steps to take if they get a diagnosis? Is that a question that you could answer?
Yeah, that's a loaded question. That's a big one. Well, I think, first of all, you have to know that there's hope. And if you don't know that recovery is possible, how do you know what a end result could be, you know, and you want to shoot for the stars if you're able. And so so for me, that was told to me really early in the process. And so that was definitely something that I held on to. You know, there was times when I didn't know if that was going to come, and for a lot of families that won't come, but there is always hope for progress. And so knowing that and always never giving up, knowing that it's a marathon, right, that you say a lot. The education piece is really important, and not being in denial, and not, you know, just realizing that this is where I am today, and this is that tomorrow is another day, and this is what I need to deal with right away. That was something that kept me going. And also, that all is tied into a faith, you know, to having that that something else that you can hold on to besides this child that might be tantruming on the floor. You know, sometimes you need to have that. But I really believed in good ABA. For me, that was something that was pivotal. And so, if families can somehow get access to that. That is really an important piece. Mm-hmm. And then, like I kind of mentioned earlier, making sure your child is feeling good so that they're able to receive that good therapy. That's a very important piece of the puzzle.
All good pieces
yes,
of advice.
Yes, very good.
I have a question that's a little off the beaten track. Do you ever, because you get an opportunity now to work with autism families and to help them to gain access to the things that they need. Mm-hmm. Do you have survivor guilt? Do you look and see how well your son did and sometimes have that guilt that you see other kids who are still making progress but they didn't get to the recovered? Is there a part of you that feels a little guilty
yeah.
or bad sometimes?
Yeah, and I, that's, yes, thank you for asking that, because I think sometimes, I mean, how could, it seems so, like, who cares if you have survivor guilt? The bigger picture is that your son is recovered. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I do, and I definitely say why us. Mm-hmm. And now in my role at ACT Today, I feel like I know the answer of why us. Why mm-hmm. was that recovery possible? And mm-hmm. now it's that enabled me to be able to step into a role at ACT Today to help other families. And so,
that's awesome.
Yeah.
It's awesome. But we know that a certain percentage of kids, if they're given the quality ABA therapy, they are going to recover. Mm-hmm. And your son definitely fit into that mold. It was really like two and a half years that mm-hmm. he got a recovery diagnosis.
Yeah.
And we know that, as you said, that isn't going to be possible for all of our kids. Our kids are still working on it.
Yeah, you know, my son didn't get ABA until he was five.
Mm-hmm.
So, because we just were not informed, and we were in a, you know, an area and a time in our lives where we thought we would learn the latest research, but that just wasn't the case. It didn't get to us.
But how much progress have you had?
Oh, we've had a huge amount of progress.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't even imagine without his program where Wyatt would be today.
And same thing for us. We're not there yet. I say we're still going to get there. And I think you're in the same boat, aren't you? We're going to get there. But the progress that we've had is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think enough gets said about that. I'm always a big fan of, we got to drill that recovery is possible, and that even when all of our kids don't get to recovery, the progress is still amazing.
And to me, that's a form of recovery. They may not be completely recovered, but you call recovery bringing back, right?
Yes.
We use that all the time. You know, mm-hmm. we're recovering a country after maybe a devastating earthquake, mm-hmm. or we're recovering. There's going to be possibly not complete recovery
right.
in every case. But we do know every child and adult with autism can be made better with the proper care and
That's
treatment.
Absolutely, mm-hmm. absolutely true. So tell us now, so you got this recovered
mm-hmm.
designation. What is life like now?
Well, first let me tell you that we had a party.
Oh, yeah.
I want you to know we invited 100 people and we had a big right. party, because it is a celebration.
Yes.
And it was a time in our lives that I'm very grateful that we're not in anymore. But life is normal now. Mm-hmm. Life is still filled with, you must have a bite of your broccoli or you're not leaving the dinner table. But it is, the bite is taken within
right.
minutes, instead of having him tantrum and fall asleep at the table and wake up to it the next morning.
Mm-hmm.
So life is good. Life is watching him play baseball or invent something with, yesterday he brought me a pencil holder he made with his Legos, or uh-huh. have a sleepover with some friends. So it's very normal.
And is there anything that you see that's a remnant of the autism that you see in him? Or I mean, I've seen your child, and I don't think I could pick him out as somebody who had a diagnosis in a group of kids. I think I would be, that would be impossible for me.
Really? I see things like occasionally some odd sounds come out, you know, that might be like, Justin, come on, be quiet. Like, let's, you know.
Right.
His sister, his teenage sister, will often call him weird, which, you know.
That
seems typical.
So, but for the most part, he is, like you said, completely indistinguishable. I mean, there might be, he might maybe get a little more sensitive when the handball court doesn't go as fairly as he wanted it to,
right.
but he's got two other buddies that are backing him up. So, you know, I just think it's all kind of relative.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So.
And he knows. He knows that he recovered.
He does.
And
mm-hmm.
what kinds of things does he say about that?
I think, first of all, he didn't know that he had autism until he recovered. We didn't really talk about it. Uh-huh. But now he sees that he actually said, we were talking about our purpose in life the other day, and he said, I don't even know if I have a purpose, Mom. And I said, hey, you've already fulfilled a purpose. Yeah. You've already, you know. So I think he has, like, this a self-esteem about him that, mm-hmm. like, he feels very special that he's accomplished something. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, he's just doing great.
He's precious.
Yeah.
He's absolutely precious.
He really is.
All right, I have a question for you. Recently, your story was featured in a large news media.
Yes.
A big story that they did about ABA, and in particular featured your story, and there was a lot of hubbub around that story that we've all expressed opinions here, and I'm wondering mm-hmm. what you thought of it.
Well, I felt like I can only talk to how they presented our family and right. Justin's journey. For me, I definitely wrote a little letter to the editor thinking that they did not show a full picture. It was so specialized on just the ABA, which was, as we all know, is a very important component, right. but it was one of many things that we did for Justin. And so I felt like it wasn't a complete picture with that. And then also, I think it led the reader to doubt whether my son had autism. Hmm. And that made me very angry because I gave the reporters all the information that they needed mm-hmm. to make a very good piece, mm-hmm. and so I didn't like the way that was portrayed.
I can only imagine because I read it and they weren't talking about my child in particular, and I was furious. I was furious because one of the quotes from one of the experts was that, you know, these kids who get the recovered probably weren't diagnosed properly. And there's nothing to base that on. There's no mm-hmm. science to back that up. And no. it's amazing to me that you can call out an entire profession of people and say that they're wrong with absolutely nothing to back it up. We wouldn't allow that with anything else.
No, we wouldn't.
And so it just tore my ticket, is yeah. what I said.
Yeah, yeah. It was a definite bias there. And anyway, the controversies continued.
Yes, people are going to say things, but how wonderful that you get to still stand up and say, really, you don't believe? Come to my house.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Take
yeah.
a look at my life.
What was really, proof. Really fun for us was that it came out, and the school that my son goes to did not know mm-hmm. about it. No, you know, very few parents knew about it. None of the teachers knew about his prior mm-hmm. diagnosis. Mm-hmm. So we came back, you know, they saw it and thought, why is he on the front page
right.
here? You know, what's going on? So
interesting. And you mentioned that you now, both of you have mentioned that you work with ACT Today mm-hmm. and you're very involved there. Tell us about what some of the programs that you are involved with and what's coming up.
Oh, sure. Well, we always have something going on
yes,
at ACT Today.
Yes,
we are very
that's
busy.
That's a loaded question. There was some of the programs she's involved with all of the programs.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but our most upcoming program is to highlight our ACT Today for Military Families program. And in that program, we have a dedicated fund to support military families that are impacted with autism. And so not only are we providing awareness about the issue and how they have a higher diagnosis rate than the regular population, but just also that they have they need extra supports based on their lifestyle. So we have a big run that will be on April 7th down at Mission Bay in San Diego, California. And we are envisioning, I think there will be about 1,500 runners there.
This year I'm letting Laura run instead of have to work the entire morning. She's got a team. Well, that's working.
You're right.
You're fundraising. Right. You've got Team Justin.
Yes. So if anybody would like to make a donation to Team Justin.
Yeah. You can go on our website and make a donation to Laura. Team.
That's right.
And it really is a fun day. We have entertainment and great bands and stars and anchor people and the troops, you know, they come out in full force to run. And we've got an Easter egg hunt going on and it's such an important, it's a fun way to support an important issue.
Absolutely.
And that is the lack of support military families receive for their children with autism.
And I'm coming this this year. Jem and I are coming. We're coming to do it. And if people want more information, they can find it on your website, on Act Today's website, but we'll also have it on our resources tab on the blog. But what else in terms of anything else you want to
Well, you're here, we have a lot of new programs that are going on at Act Today. This is the year of the program. So we have launched our safety initiative program. Safety First. We just gave out 13 grants last week for safety programs. We have our assistive technology. We just donated 20 iPads this last week for that. And then we continue to support families with ABA and skills. We can get a grant from for skills. We also have our biomedical, medical care, and summer programs as well. We support
a wide range for what families need. I think that's there's so many things I love about Act Today, but I would have to say that's the main thing, that you guys provide the care for what people ask for.
You're not
telling them what they need.
Right.
They tell you, and you help them to be able to do it.
Yeah. As long as they are the provider is verified and is of good quality, which we check out, we realize that parents know best, and we're not going to dictate what they need.
It's a wonderful thing that you ladies do.
Well, thank you.
You guys are an inspiration.
We love doing
to
it.
All of us.